Okay, number four gives us a picture of a cube. Okay. Something we know about a cube is that all the side lengths are the same, the length, width, height, all the same. It tells us the volume is 216. Okay, now how do you get the volume of a box in general? Go ahead, Katie. Length, width, and height, and let's talk about that. What is that measuring? I mean, it's measuring the volume, but it's... Well, squares are flat, right? Yeah, how many little cubes? So area squares, cube is, or what, volume is cubes, okay? The three-dimensional square. So like, here's an example cube right here. And the volume of a box is a measure of how many of those cubes can fit inside that entire thing, okay? So with a cube, we should be able to take this side length times this side length times this side length. Of course, these are all the same, so side times side times side is the same as?
Volume.
Volume, right? But like using exponents, side times side times side.
S cubed.
To the third power, S cubed. If you can believe that's an S.
It's a 5,
Jake. S cubed. Well, S cubed should come out to be 216, right? So we're looking for a number that multiplies by itself three times to give you 216. Wouldn't take long. We'd have to even guess that many numbers to figure out. But that guy would have to be what? 6. You can try 2. Well, that's going to come out to be 8. You can try 3. That's going to come out to be 27. 4 comes out to be 64. 5 comes out to be 125. 6 times 6 times 6 gives you 216. Number 13. That's the fourth root of 256. The fourth root of 256. Okay? You just are starting to understand what a fourth root means. Someone explain what the fourth root of 256 means, not necessarily what number it is.
Number
to the fourth has to be
equal to 257.
Well, it just needs to, if I take this number that is the fourth root of 256, if I take it to the fourth power, it needs to come out to be 256. Okay, how would I say this? Fourth root of 256. Fourth root of 256. Okay, so we try 2, that'll come out to be 16. 3, that'll be 81. I think it's 4. 4 to the 4th, I think it's 256. So this number must be 4 because 4 to the 4th gives us 256. So we say 4th root. Just like Caden said, we're looking for a number that will, when we raise it to the fourth power, or when we multiply it by itself four times, gives us the number in the radical, in the root symbol. That's it. Any questions? Okay, today for the review, I want you to get your little your cards out, okay? For some reason you don't have yours, which is the last time I'm going to be really nice about it. Raise your hand if you don't have yours. Okay. Make sure I got everybody. So far I got one person who doesn't have theirs, is that right? Okay. Let me see if I have one sitting here. Just coming out. Alright, so you know how it goes by now. I'm going to put up a question, multiple choice, hold the card up, pointing in the right direction for the answer that you feel is correct. Everybody ready?
Yep.
Okay, since it is like a quiz, you know, no talking or discussing what you think the answer is. Just find which one you think is the answer, hold it up, don't block it with your finger, and yeah.
Yeah, you can do it.
Where were you just a second ago? I was just asking. All right,
we're looking for it.
Let's see. No discussion. No telling other people what you think the answer is. You just hold it up. And, alright. Here's the first one. Fourth group. 81. Hold up the card for you think the answer is. If you have a calculator handy, you're welcome to use a calculator. Double check, make sure that the answer you feel is correct, is the correct answer. Okay, the next one, just two questions. It's the third root of 130. Use what you know about these roots. Approximate what you think the answer is. you change theirs? Cool. Well, first one, y'all did very, very well. Okay. This one is 3C. Okay. And why is that? Can someone explain that? Why is it 3, Sean?
Because 3 to the power of 4 is 81.
Okay. If you had your calculator handy, how would you double check to make sure that that's correct? Anyone else? Anyone besides Sean or Cadence? Can you explain how you use your calculators? Grady?
Well, you do 3 times 3, which is 9. You do another 2 times 3, which is 9 times 9.
Sounds like you did that in your head.
Yeah.
Did you do it with your calculator?
No.
Did it with your head. Okay, so he just kind of saw the 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. By the way, that's what I was looking for. If you had your calculator, just 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. We're done. And Brady says, well, look at this. This is a 9. This is a 9. And I know 9 times 9 is 81. That works too.
It's beautiful.
Caden? None of the other ones would work, yeah. So I got a 9. So what might someone who picked a 9 might have made a mistake?
Just a square root.
Right, just saw the root symbol. Maybe the day before we learned about these other kinds of roots, we might have chosen the square root because we recognize that as the square root symbol. Why 20.25? How would somebody maybe wind up with 20.25? Kids? Divide 81 by 4, that's how I came up with that one. But how about this last one, 4096? Josie?
You multiplied 81 to the power of 4?
Maybe 81 to the 4th, yeah, that actually is what it was. 81 to the 4th power, 4096. Okay. There we go, 3 to the 4th is 81, so 3 is the 4th root of 81. Bring that out. Move on to the next one. Okay. Third root of 130 is 5.065797-ish. Okay? It's about that much. Everybody understand what I meant by ish?
Yes.
Okay. What about 5? What would you say about 5, kids?
Well,
okay, so just kind of stuck in your head by now. Mm-hmm. 5 to the third power is 125, so close, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, what about 6?
Oh.
It's too far, right? 5 is too small, 6 is too big. So, it's the only one that really makes sense. This one, I think again, it took 130 divided by 3 to get 43.3 repeated. Okay. So remember the third root, or the fourth root, or whatever, like for this example, third root of 130 means a number that multiplies by itself 3 times to give you the number that's inside the radical there. Okay. And our estimation, we can estimate pretty well if we know some cubes, like 5 cubed is 125, 6 cubed, does anybody remember what 6 times 6 times 6 is?
216.
216, that was the answer to, well, it was related to the answer in number 4. Okay. So 5 cubed, too big, 6 cubed, or 5 cubed is too small, 6 cubed is too big, somewhere between 5 and 6 is what the cube root of 130 has to be.
Yep.
All right. Good job. So now what I'm going to do, and you're going to write in your notes all that you are going to learn today, right? I'm going to prove to you 4 to the 1/2 power. Kind of a weird thing. Here's the neat thing about exponents is I can understand what 4 cubed means, right? Multiply 4 this many times. 4 cubed, 4 times 4 times 4. Okay, I get that. Negative exponents. I like to imagine that the person who invented exponents was approached by somebody else who's like, okay, so I've been playing around your exponents. But what would it mean if the exponent was negative? Okay, well, so the inventor of exponents goes back to his exponent lab and he's figuring it out, and he decides, like, well, a negative exponent would have to mean, like, 4 to the negative 2 would have to mean the same thing as 1 over 4 to the positive power of 2. So here we come with another question. Someone asks the inventor of exponents, what does 4 to the 1/2 power mean? Okay? Do you have a reason why you have this answer?
Yes.
Okay, why? What's your answer and why?
Well, my answer is 8.
4 to the 1/2 is 8?
Yes. Because
okay, why?
4. 4 times half of 4, which is 2.
Okay, that's 4 times 1/2 of 4 is 8. But, see, what I'm doing here is, I mean, you're guessing what 1/2 might be, and that's fine. What we want to do is make sure that whatever this exponent is, it follows all the properties of exponents that we've learned so far. Okay, so when we multiply 4 to the 1/2 times 4 to something else, right, properties should work out that way. When I take 4 to the 1/2 to a power, the property of multiplying exponents should be consistent. 4 to the 1/2 divided by 4 to something else, the property of subtracting exponents should work, and so on. Okay? So, I'm just going to try something different today, as much as I like discussing this. I'm just going to prove to you that 4 to the 1/2 would have to be the same as the square root of 4. Okay? Let's just break this into, you know, a left half and a right half of this paper, and look at what these numbers would have to be. All right? Tell me what the square root of 4 is. We're so familiar with it. What's the square root of 4 and why? Somebody new today? Somebody, Johnny?
2 plus 2 times 2 is 4.
It's 2 because, let's put like a little thought bubble over here, because 2 times 2 is 4. Okay. Well, let's look at this number. 4 to the 1/2. Well, with some thinking and some contemplating the properties of exponents, if I multiply 4 to the 1/2 times 4 to the 1/2, okay, so just an idea that I came up with, 4 to the 1/2 times 4 to the 1/2, if I multiply these together, I should be able to take the exponents and do what with them?
Multiply them together.
Add them.
Which
is it?
Add.
Let's just double check. Okay, get ourselves a little thinking over here. Like if I add 4 to the 7th times 4 to the 3rd, what should that be? 4 to the what?
10.
Why, Grady?
Because there's 4 sevenths.
4 sevenths?
But, and then there's 4 threes, so you just add it together and then you times them all.
You said there's 4 sevens and then there's 4 threes.
I mean, there's 7 fours.
7 fours.
3 fours.
7 fours times 3 more fours, 10 fours. Right? It should be able to add those exponents. Remember that property? Should be able to add the exponents. So this should be 4 to the what?
First power.
To the first power. What's 4 to the first power?
4.
4, right? 4 squared is 16. 4 times 4. 4 to the first just is itself. Anything to the first power is just itself. So 4 to the 1/2 times 4 to the 1/2 would have to be 4. So this is a number. This is an identical number. What's a number that multiplies by itself to give you 4?
2.
It's got to be 2. Okay. Same reasoning. The square root of 4 is 2 because 2 times 2 is 4. That's how square roots were explained to you probably the first time you heard of a square root. What's a square root mean? Well, it means a number times itself. It gives you 4. Well, 4 to the 1/2 would have to multiply by 4 to the 1/2 and would have to give you 4, which is the exact same idea. A number that has to multiply by itself to give you 4 is the square root of 4. Chuck?
So why did you multiply it twice if the exponent doesn't have this? You know, if you want to multiply something twice, it should have the exponent too. Why did you multiply it twice if it has exponent 1/2?
Well, like I said, it was all in the process of proving to you that 4 to the 1/2 is the same as the square root of 4, okay? And so, like all this stuff, we get it. We've seen it before. We understand that stuff. Why did I multiply 4 to the 1/2 times 4 to the 1/2? Because it proves to you that 4 to the 1/2 is the same as the square root of 4. It's, well, this is not telling me to multiply it by itself. I guess I should say that kind of where I know that this is 2 because of all this.
Yeah.
Maybe I kind of go backwards and say, well, what if I try, right? This is just my thinking. What if I try taking 4 to the 1 half and multiplying it by 4 to the 1 half? Well, that gives me 4 to the 1, which tells me that, right, both of these have to be
2.
Therefore, this must also be 2.
So it could just be 4 times 1 half, which would give me 2.
Oh, okay. I see that's an unfortunate coincidence. Let's try this. I'm going to show you that 9 to the 1 half is equal to the square root of 9. Okay, same reasoning. The square root of 9 is 3, and my thinking behind that is that 3 times 3 is 9. That tells me that the square root of 9 is 3, right?
Mm-hmm.
Square root of 9 is 3. Cadence? What's that?
Could the square root be -3?
Could be. Yeah. If I just say square root of 9, we just kind of, one of those things that we agree to in math, is if I just say what's the square root of 9, you say 3, right? But in other situations, let me pull your attention away from this for a second, okay? So if I just say square root of 9, you think, that's 3. But if I say, solve this equation, okay? Well, okay, so some number times itself gives you 9. Now I have to give all the possible values of x that could do this, which is what you're saying, Kate. 3 could do it, but -3 could do it. So I'd have to give you 2 answers. X could be 3, but then again, x could be -3. Those are 2 valid answers. You don't have to pick one. They're both valid answers. Okay. So just a quick answer to your question there. We'll get more into that later. Much later. Well, you know, not much later, but a bit later right now. Yeah?
Once you put the square root of -9 and then multiply by -1, or you put negative where the, like on the left side of the radical.
Yeah, you can say, so if I wanted -3, I would say negative square root of 9, and so the square root of 9 is 3, and negative of that is -3. But when we get into solving equations with x squareds, and then we get into the positives and the negatives, like all at the same time. But to try and work out what 9 to the 1 half might mean, I know that when I multiply 9s that have exponents, I add their exponents together. It's a totally valid thing to be able to do. Or it should be. That's the thing about these exponents, is we want the properties that make sense to continue to work even when the exponents are a little more mysterious. Okay. When the power is 1/2, it's like, what does that mean? Well, it's gotta mean this, because I should be able to use those properties even when the exponents are fractions. We did the same thing for negative exponents. So this property of multiplying a 9 with an exponent times another 9 with an exponent, being 9 to some new exponent that we get from adding these two together, that should work for 9 to the 1/2 as well. 9 to the 1/2 times 9 to the 1/2 is 9 to the first power. So this is a number. This is the exact same number. 9 to the 1/2 and 9 to the 1/2. Obviously, they're exactly the same number. So what number times the exact same number gives you 9?
3.
3, but not 4.5, not half. So that's got to be 3, if I can write a 3, that's got to be 3, it's got to be 3 times 3. So this is also has to be 3.
So when you do, like, 2 to the third power, you write out 2 times 2 times 2.
Mm-hmm.
So this one, would you just write 9 to the 1/2?
We mean... So let me write down what you've said so far. When you have 2 to the third, you write down 2 times 2 times 2.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But when you have 9 to the 1/2, what's your question?
When you write down
Right. That's the thing. Like when it's a positive whole number, this makes a lot of sense. It's just like instructions for what to do with 2. This is less obvious. What are the instructions here for what do I do with 9? Okay? Essentially, if you're saying 2 to the third, right, 2 times 2 times 2, if you want to answer this question, like 9 to the 1 half, what does that mean? We could say it means the square root of 9. Right? You see 9 to the 1 half, take the square root of 9. In the same way that 2 to the third means 2 times 2 times 2, 9 to the 1 half means take the square root of 9, find the square root of 9. Find a number that when multiplied by itself gives you 9. It's not obvious why this is, as obvious as this is, okay? But, again, when we give the reasoning like we did back here, we can start to see, like, okay, it's not obvious that 9 to the 1 half should be the same as the square root of 9, just like it's obvious that 2 to the third is 2 times 2 times 2. That's really easy to see. It's not obvious, but I can see why it makes sense, right? And so now I can start to see the connection. When I see 9 to the 1 half, I'll just think square root 9. Yeah.
So like the way you're showing us is that if you add 2 of 9 and 1 halves together and then divide that, I would, put that in the square root, and that's your...
Well, I'm showing you that if 1 half is a valid exponent that I could have, like if that could possibly make sense, I should be able to multiply a 9 to the 1 half times another 9 to the 1 half. And the property of adding the exponents should still be true. I should get 9 to the first. Okay, so what we have here, what we see here, is essentially the same thing we're asking here. We see that there's a number that multiplies by itself that gives you 9. That's obviously what has to be able to happen if 9 to the 1 half is like a valid exponent that we could have. That's the same question we're asking here. There's some number that multiplies by itself to give you 9. There's some number that multiplies by itself to give you 9. We're saying the same thing. So by doing that, I'm kind of proving to you that 9 to the 1 half would have to be the same thing as the square root of 9. A number that multiplies by itself to give you 9. Okay? It should work in like all the properties should be applicable. If I said 16 to the 1 half, okay, it would be 4. I know it would have to be the square root of 16. I'll use a different property to show you that this has to be so. Okay, so this number, 16 to the 1 half, whatever it is, right, this is just my thinking. If I take it to the second power, okay, this is the proof part. This is not the answer part. This is the proof to show you that this guy has to be 4. Well, when I raise a power, like a number to a power, and raise that to a power, what do I do with those two powers? What can I do?
Multiply.
You can multiply those together. What's 1 half times 2?
1.
So that's 16 to the first power. So this number squared has to give me 16. What number squared gives you 16?
4.
So again, in a different way, I show you that it must be 4. And this must be 4 because we're a little more familiar with that. Right? Why is 4 the square root of 16? Because 4 times 4, well, I guess we're using this idea, 4 squared is 16. It's got to be that way because 4 squared is 16. This number squared gives you 16, so that number's got to be 4. Yeah.
What if the, like, it's not a number that gives you a nice square root, so it's like
15. It's like the square, 15 to the 1 half?
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't come out nicely.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if this makes sense to you what the square root of 15 is, then this will make sense to do the same thing. And so the square root of 15, well, the square root of 16 is 4. So the square root of 15 must be just below 4.
Yeah.
So 15 to the 1 half must also be just below, they're the same number, must
okay.
be just below 4. Okay, how about 8 to the 1/3 power? What do you think that is?
Would be
this is 2. Because, why?
2 times 2 times 2 is 8.
If I multiply 3 of these together, I get 8. So the third root of 8 is 2. Because if I multiply 3 of them together, I get 8. The same thing is true here. It's just kind of like backwards. I'm going to show you that if I multiply 3 of these together, I would have to get 8. Let me show you. Here's my thinking part. 8 to the 1/3 times 8 to the 1/3 times 8 to the 1/3 has to be 8, because 8 to the 1/3 times 8 to the 1/3 would be 8 to the 2/3 times another 8 to the 1/3 would be 8 to the 3/3, which would be 8 to the 1. So I'm looking for a number that, right, 3 of the same number that multiply together to give you 8. That has to be 2 times 2 times 2. So this also has to be 2. Well, 1/3 of 8 so 1/3 of 8 means like 3 numbers that add together to give you 8. 1/3 in the exponent realm would mean a number that multiplies by itself 3 times to give you 8, which is 2. Sean?
What if it's like 2 to the 3rd, 8 to the 2 over 3?
8 to the 2/3 power?
Yeah.
That's a good question.
That's a really good question. Okay. But before we go there, let's talk about the movie before. So just to work our way up to there, any number, let's say n, now let's say x. Let's not be silly. X to the 1 over n power, that just means you're taking the nth root of that number. The 1/5th power, the 5th root. Okay, so for example, 32 to the 1/5th power, that's the same as the 5th root of 32, that's 2. Because 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 gives me 32. I multiply 5 of these things together, 32 to the 1/5 times 32 to the 1/5 times 32, all those 1/5th powers add up to a power of 1, right? 32 to the 1, and so 32 to the 1/5 has to be the same as the 5th root of 32, has to be 2. Any questions? We're leaving for a second. This number has a 1. We're about to answer Sean's question. What if it's a 2? What do we do with that? So if there's any questions before we do that, please ask. So, I mean, all the explanation, did it make a lot of sense? You can at least remember this, but you know, I don't want that to be the only thing I offer you. I'm offering you understanding of why this is. And the more you understand why, the less you have to think really hard about stuff. Now, thinking really hard a lot of times comes from trying to remember things that you could have understood why. All right. If there's no more questions, I'm going to, like, let's talk about Sean's question. What if it's a 2/3 power? So I think the easiest way to answer this question is, if it's a 2/3 power, 5/4 power, whatever power it is, splitting that up into two powers, two different powers, is the easiest way, I think, to explain all that. So let me just remind you of this. Let's say I take 5 to the 2nd and take that to the 3rd. That'd be 5 to the what?
6.
To the 6th, because there's 3 groups of 5 to the 2nd power, right? 3 groups of 2 5s, that's 5 to the 6th. And 3 to the 8th to the 4th is 3 to the 32nd power, okay? Because 4 groups of 8 3s would give me in total 32 3s to multiply together. Let's take 7 to the 12th. Would you agree? I could write 7 to the 12th as 7 to the 3rd to the 4th?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I could write it as 7 to the 4th to the 3rd?
Yes.
I could write it as 7 to the 6th to the 2nd power?
Yes.
Right? Any way that I can factor 12, I can write this out like that. So far, so good?
Yes.
That is the key, I feel, to making the most sense out of 8 to the 2/3. Let's use that property to break this up to something we have newly come to understand and then something that we totally already get. Okay. I'm going to write it as 8 to the 1/3 raised to the what? You say cadence raised to the what power?
Second.
Do you agree with cadence that I could write it as 8 to the 1/3 to the second power?
Yes.
Should be able to multiply these powers together, right?
Yep.
8 to the, so we got 1/3 times 2 is 1/3 times 2, 2/3?
Yes.
Yeah, 1/3 times 2 is 2/3. So these two are the same.
Yes.
These two are the same. But what's 8 to the 1/3? We just learned. 8 to the 1/3 is? Great.
Maybe 2 times 2 times 2.
No, 8 to the 1/3 is just
2.
2. Because 2 times 2 times 2 is 8. So 8 to the 1/3 is 2. All right, so I just found out what 8 to the 1/3 was, and now I'm going to take that to the second power, which is?
4.
4. Yeah.
When Sharman said it, and I thought, well, that's just what I thought is this. The same thing I said, I just would like. So, 1/3 is 4. 1/3 of the 8 is 2, and 2 of those is 4.
So you kind of thought, okay, 8 to the 1/3, that's 2. And we have 2 of those, so 2 times 2. We could also say, I mean, it's the same reasoning, basically, but 8 to the 1/3 times another 8 to the 1/3. If I multiply those together, I add the exponents, I get 8 to the 2/3. I know this is 2, just from all the stuff we learned a few minutes ago. That's 2, that's 2, 2 times 2 is 4. So if all that just, like, sunk in, no problem, then now we know pretty much everything we need to know about fraction exponents. Probably didn't. So let's continue to take notes because you're all taking excellent notes, I'm sure. Your papers are blank. Why would they be blank? You're trying to learn something new? Crazy thing to try. Let's try 125 to the 2/3 power. Brady, what do you say? I'm gonna encourage everybody to approach it this way, to split it up into 125 to something power, raise it to something power.
A 125 to the 1/3 power.
Uh-huh.
And then with a power of 2.
The power of 2, because 1/3 times 2 is 2/3.
Knew that 125 to a power of 1/3 is 5.
Why is that?
Because 5 times 5 times 5 is 125.
Right, and we know like several things. Like this has to be multiplied by itself 3 times to give you 5. It's the same as the cube root of 125. Okay, so now we have a 5 inside the parentheses and we're squaring it.
And then 5 times 5 would be 25.
Exactly. So 125 to the 2/3 power is 25. Look at your homework here on the board. Okay, one last one. We don't have a whole lot of time, so I'm just going to show you just one last example. 256 to the 5/4. I'm going to take 256 to the 1/4 power, raise that to the 5th power. That's basically the 4th root of 256. After I figure out what that is, I raise it to the 5th power. You know what the 4th root of 256 is?
4.
It is 4. 4 to the 5th? I don't know. 4 to the 5th off the top of my head. 6 times 4. 256 times 4, is what it is, 1024. All right, have a good day, everybody. Good luck.